Hello, my name is Carol Galloway. Welcome to A User's Guide to Democracy. As you can see, I am recording this in my home, but I'm a high school teacher, and one of the courses that I teach is AP Comparative Government and Politics. It is my hope that this series will prove useful to new voters, people who are interested in exercising their right to the franchise for the first time, and anybody who just needs a refresher course over civics education. So let's go ahead and get started, shall we? So today, in this short video, what we're going to do is we're going to do two major things. We're going to talk about the goals of this series, what I intend to do over the course of these videos, and we're going to address kind of the central question here of what is a democracy? Now, obviously, that second topic is enormous, and it's something that people spend their entire academic careers studying, and I do not intend for this one short video to sufficiently address the concepts and the history of the development of democracy. But I do want to give you some baseline understandings about what democratic principles really are before we move into the nitty-gritty of how to participate in a democracy, which is what we'll be doing later on in this series. So for goals for this series, some big things, like I said, I want to provide some information for first-time voters. I also wanted to do this not just for first-time voters, but for people who have voted before and aren't really sure they understand how the process works, or people who aren't sure that they should vote or aren't sure if they're allowed to. So I want to kind of go through sort of the gamut of who might be affected by questions about the franchise. Additionally, the purpose of this series is to reinforce and review civic education. As a social studies teacher, I think it's really critical. It's in fact, for me, the hallmark of what public education is meant to do. It is meant to provide for us an informed electorate, people capable of making public decisions. Unfortunately, in a lot of states, civic education has kind of fallen by the wayside. In the state of Georgia, high school students only have to have a half credit in order to be able to graduate in terms of their civic education. And part of that is because I want my students to participate in civic life. I want all of my colleagues to participate in civic life. I want my friends and my families, the people who I haven't seen in years, I want everyone to be engaged. The more people who are engaged in our democratic process, the better, in my view. And so I'm really trying to encourage my students to participate civically, to understand how power relates to their lives and how they can use power. So, because I am living and working in Georgia, what this series is going to do is it's going to focus in on election law and practices in Georgia. So if you are living somewhere outside of Georgia, a lot of the specifics that I'm going to talk about in terms of primaries and registering to vote and absentee ballots, that sort of stuff is going to be particular to your state and locality. The U.S. federal system in terms of elections means that elections are decentralized and they're handled by local governances. And so as a result, you need to do your own research for your own state. I can help you provide in resources and places where you should look for that information. But for this series, I'm going to focus in on Georgia law and practice. So let's go ahead and get started. What is a democracy? If your gut instinct tells you that a democracy is a system where people vote, that is part of the answer. It's not all of the answer. A democracy, broadly, in its purest form, is a system where political and governmental power flows from the people into systems of power, okay? Where power is coming from the people into governmental structures. Demos, for Greek, is peoples, kratos is power. A democracy is simply people power. And yes, elections are critical parts of that. They're really important, but they're not the only important part to a democracy. Broadly, democracies have three main characteristics. They are marked by public participation. That is regular people, not political elites, not the wealthy, not the military, but regular people are participating in governance. That is a hallmark of a democracy. They are competitive. A competitive democratic system has a wealth of ideas and news sources available. You are not just getting your information from one source in a democratic system. There should be a competitive marketplace of ideas, and human beings within that system are able to evaluate evaluate and use that information to make choices. And number three, they are free to do so. A democracy is hallmarked by liberty. Now, this doesn't mean that we're talking about liberty to do whatever you want to anyone you want. That would be anarchy. Instead, we are talking about a preservation of individual rights and freedoms, like freedom of the press, freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, freedom to protest. All of those things constitute what we call classical liberalism, and they are hallmarks to a substantive democratic system. A substantive democratic system is a system with rules. Those rules are publicly available and people know them, okay? So it's sort of like expecting somebody to play Monopoly. If they don't know the rules, they are going to lose. So a democracy has rules, and we should all know what they are. And that's what civic education is for, is so that we all know the rules. And you may not like the rules, you may think the rules need to change, and certainly that is something that can happen in a democratic system. But you have to know the rules, and you have to agree that there are rules. Democracies additionally have civil societies. Civil societies are voluntary associations of people. The public gets to voluntarily group together. These can be in political parties, they can be in clubs and organizations, but civil society is where people find value and where people learn how to organize themselves. So a free and open civil society is critical to a substantive democratic practice. Democracies, like I said, are competitive. There is not just one line of thought, there are multiple, and they are allowed to be expressed. Now, not all thoughts are exactly equal. Some are fringe, and we'll get into what constitutes sort of like free speech versus hate speech. But right now, what you need to understand is that in a democratic system, we are talking about a competitive environment with different ideas, different people running for office, and people having access to those things. Democracies have free and fair elections. That means that they are transparent, they are honest, they are open, and they can be reviewed. Okay, the rules are available ahead of time. The understanding of how those rules will be applied is determined before the election occurs. That is what constitutes a free and fair election. Democracies additionally preserve civil rights and liberties, like I said before. So all of these characteristics, these five central ideas about substantive democracies, are things that we're going to be talking about in future episodes of this series. But there are some basic assumptions to democracy that I think are really important for all of us to kind of wrap our heads around. And those are that in a democracy, regular people have the ability to make decisions about how their lives are run. A central concept here is there is a faith in the ability of everyone to make decisions. Okay, so that is a critical element to a substantive democracy. A procedural democracy might allow people to go and vote in an election, but only some people get to vote, not everybody. But here the assumption is that everybody gets to vote. Everybody gets to make decisions about how their lives are run. Regular people have access to competitive ideas and information, and additionally, they are capable of evaluating that information and making choices based upon the information they have. What all of this assumes is that regular people on a day-to-day basis are capable of education. They are capable of learning. They are capable of changing their minds, and they are capable of rational choice. If the gut instinct within you right now is incredibly cynical and you're like, well, that's not going to happen, I implore you to think again. I went into public education with the notion that every child has the ability to learn. I entreat you, believe that of your fellow citizen. So in a democracy, people participate, they have competitive ideas, and their liberties are protected and preserved and valued. All of those things are critical to what a democracy is. And going forward in this series, what we're going to try to do is understand how those ideas, participation, competition, and liberty, interact in a practical way in your experience of democracy. So in this video, what we have done is we've identified the goals of the series. We've developed a working definition of a democracy. We've explained the basic role of public participation in democratic systems. And in our next video, what we're going to be doing is we're going to talk about what elections are and why do they matter. So that's it for me. If you want additional information on civic education, I entreat you to go to one of the four sites that I've listed here, the Georgia Center for Civic Education, the Georgia Center for the Social Studies, iCivics, and the Center for Civic Education. They're all wonderful nonprofit organizations that provide excellent information that may be helpful to you, your friends, and your family. I'll see you next time. Goodbye.